Dear all, welcome to the playlist of High Voltage Engineering. In this video, I'll be discussing on surge impedance and surge impedance loading. Surge impedance loading is also known as SIL. These terminologies are commonly used in high voltage engineering and power system. Now let us try to understand what do we mean by surge impedance. First and foremost, I would like to discuss the definition. It can be defined as the ratio of voltage and the current waves traveling along with the transmission line. Or else you can say that it is the ratio of voltage and current of a traveling wave. Moving on to the next point, surge impedance is also known as characteristics impedance. And whenever you are considering surge impedance, you will be considering the transmission line as lossless transmission line. That point you have to keep in your mind. Moreover, surge impedance is also known as natural impedance. Why? Because this impedance has nothing to do with the load impedance. So that is why it is also known as natural impedance. Whenever you are talking about surge impedance, the following parameters will be exempted. You are not considering the following parameters. The parameters such as series resistance and shunt conductance will not be considered whenever you are talking about surge impedance. So these are the introduction to surge impedance. Now let us understand the mathematical analysis of surge impedance. Before explaining the mathematical analysis, I would like to talk about the long transmission line. Regarding the long transmission line, the length of the transmission line will be more than 250 km. If I talk about long transmission line, I would like to consider distributed inductance and the capacitance. That is very important. So what is the function of the particular capacitance? What is the role of the capacitance? Suppose whenever the line is charged, the capacitive component that will be feeding to the reactive power. And also the inductive component that will absorb the reactive power. Definitely there will be in a long transmission line. So there will be the shunt impedance. And also we can say that there will be capacitive component and inductive component. Capacitive component will be connected as a shunted manner. Okay, shunted in the sense parallel, and inductive component will be serial fashion. In case of capacitive component, that will supply reactive power, where the inductive component that will absorb the reactive power. So normal condition, I mean in the sense balanced condition, the capacitive component that will supply reactive power, that will be directly equal to inductive component which will be absorbing the reactive power. That means the reactive power which is supplying by the capacitive component will be equal to reactive power which is absorbing by the inductive component. Okay, so that is a concept. So we can explain with the help of a mathematical analysis. So first and the foremost, I would like to tell you that what is the total amount of reactive power which is supplying by the capacitor. You can able to note down. So here V square by X is in the sense the total amount of the reactive power which is supplying by the capacitive component. V square divided by XC. What do you mean by V? V is nothing but phase voltage. Similarly, what is XC? XC is nothing but the capacitive reactance which is expressed in terms of Ω. Similarly, the how much amount of reactive power which is absorbing by the inductive component, that is regarding the expression I square into XL. What do you mean by I? I is nothing but the line current. So what is XL? XL in the sense the inductive reactance. Okay, inductive reactance in the sense L into omega. L is known, where L is known as inductance and omega is called the angular frequency. What is XC? XC is nothing but 1 by C omega. Okay, so this is a basic expression. So for your convenience, what I have done is I have calculated and I have made a final expression. I would like to show you the final expression. So you have to remember that the how much amount of reactive power which is supplying by the capacitive component, that is given by V square by XC. And also you have to understand that how much amount of reactive power which is absorbing by the inductive component, that is called I square into XL. Now let us, for a balanced condition, let us equate the reactive power which is supplying by the capacitive component and the reactive power which is absorbing by the inductive component. Now you can see the expression. So V square by XC, that is equal to V square divided by XL. Okay, hope it is very clear. So V square divided by, what is expression for XC? The expression for XC is given by 1 by C omega. So expression for XL is known as L into omega, that you write directly. That you can write directly as you can observe on the screen. If you simplify, it becomes V square into C omega, that is equal to I square into L omega. This is also pretty clear. Now what you can do is omega and omega will be cancelled because same term will be repeated at LHS and RHS. Of course, I have cancelled omega term. And now what are the terms which are remaining? V square C is equal to I square L. Okay. So from this expression, I am going to adjust one more thing. So I square will be taken out at LHS. So V square divided by I square, that is equal to L by C. So how from this, how to calculate V by A? So you can take the square root. So V by A is equal to square root of L by C. So what do we mean by square root of L by C? What is V by A? According to Ohm's law, this will be impedance. Okay. Root of L by C, I'll be getting as Z naught, or you can call ZS, or you can call ZC. In the textbook, some textbook you can able to say, you can able to observe ZS. Another textbook you can able to see ZC, and someone will call it as Z naught. Okay. Don't make any confusion. So the ratio of voltage to the current of a traveling wave, that is known as surge impedance, square root of L by C, that is the final expression. Okay, this is the expression for surge impedance. So this will be helpful for doing the numerical example. In the next session, I'm going to solve one numerical example based on this particular equation. That is one of the very important problem for your examination as well as design concern. Moving on to the discussion. So far, we have discussed about the importance of surge impedance. So in connection with the topic, there is another terminology that is known as surge impedance loading. It is known as SIL. What do you mean by SIL? Let us understand the definition first. A transmission line terminated with the load equal to surge impedance of the line is known as surge impedance loading. Here, the sending end voltage and receiving end voltages are same for surge impedance loading. Okay, sending end voltage VS, let us call VS, and receiving end voltage, that is called VR. So in case of surge impedance loading, okay, the sending end voltage will be equal to receiving end voltage. Okay, this is mainly concentrating for the lossless transmission line. Moving on to the discussion. Surge impedance loading is the connected load in the transmission line for which reactive power generated by the capacitor is equal to reactive power absorbed or consumed by the inductor. And also we can say that the overall flow of the reactive power will be cancelled, that is equal to zero. Okay, because we are following the balanced condition, whichever I have derived a bit early. There is an exact balance between reactive power generated by the capacitor and the reactive power consumed by the inductor. So that is actually happening in case of this special condition, that is called surge impedance loading. Okay, these two points you have to remember. And you need to take care that the reactive power is generated here by the shunt capacitors and it is consumed by the series inductor of the line. Anyway, if you talk about a transmission line, there will be always shunt capacitance. Okay, you can say shunt capacitance. Parallelly, the capacitance effect will be there. Similarly, here you can say that there will be series inductance effect, series inductor and a parallel capacitor, or you can call shunt capacitor. So shunt capacitance and series inductance has to be considered. So this terminology is generally called surge impedance loading. You have to remember what is a surge impedance and what do you mean by surge impedance loading. Why you are considering surge impedance loading? So what is application? As far as the application of surge impedance loading concerned, whenever you are going to decide the maximum loading capacity of a transmission line, you have to consider the surge impedance loading. That is a major application of SIL, or you can call surge impedance loading. That is why we are going to familiar this terminology. Okay, so this is regarding surge impedance loading and its application. So these are my references. Apart from that, I have referred some website like electricalforyou.com. So in this session, I have discussed about what do you mean by surge impedance and what do you mean by surge impedance loading as well. Surge impedance, what is the definition I have discussed first? It is the ratio of voltage and current waves of a given traveling wave or a given the waveform which is passing through the transmission line. It can be called as characteristic impedance and natural impedance. Later on, I have explained the condition. the capacitance that is generating the reactive power and the inductance of the transmission line that is absorbing the reactive power. Later I have derived one expression also. So what is the condition? Say for a balanced condition, the reactive power which is generated by the capacitor of a transmission line, capacitance of the transmission line, that is equal to the reactive power which is consuming by the inductance of the transmission line. Finally, I have derived an expression for surge impedance. Okay, once I completed the surge impedance, expression for surge impedance, I have explained about surge impedance loading definition. Later on, what are the parameters which are affecting on surge impedance loading? And finally, the application of surge impedance loading is also discussed in this session. Remaining video, the previous video which I explained related to this topic, I'll be putting up in the comment description box. You can go through that particular videos. That will be really help you out. If you are having any queries, you can put up in the comment box. Finally, thank you very much for watching this video.